Hi everyone, welcome to social science class. Dear students, because of the pandemic COVID-19 situation, the CBSE board has reduced 30% of the syllabus for the academic year 2020 and 2021. Regarding reduction of the syllabus, I am going to give a detailed information in the next. Dear students, last year we learnt the concept of democracy. What is democracy? Why democracy? Constitutional designs, electoral politics, working of institutions, and also we learnt about democratic rights. And this academic year, you are going to learn about more the same concept, that is about the democracy. And today, you are going to learn about the concept of power sharing in democratic countries. Today's topic is power sharing. In democratic countries, sharing of power among legislature, executive and judiciary, and also in a different levels of the government, it is very important to the design of democracy. So, in this class, by studying Belgium and Sri Lanka, we are going to learn about need for power sharing in democratic countries. Now, let us discuss about the power sharing arrangement in Belgium country. Belgium is one of the small country in the European Union. It shared its border with France, Netherlands, Luxembourg and Germany. And the population of this country also, it's too less. Even we cannot compare with our one of Haryana state. It has only 1.5 crore people. Even though there we can see the linguistic diversity. Means in Belgium there are many different language speakers. So the ethnic composition of this country is very complex. Now let us discuss about the ethnic composition of Belgium. What is the meaning of ethnic? In Kannada, we can say like this. Ethnic composition means Janangiya Samyojana. So, let us discuss about the ethnic composition of Belgium. In simple way, we can say like this, ethnic means a social division based on shared culture. It is a very simple definition for ethnic. A social division based on shared culture. So, now we will see that in Belgium, 59% of the people, those who are speaking Dutch language, they live in Flemish region. 59% of the people that settled in Flemish region. And they are speaking Dutch language. And 40% of the people that lives in Wallonia region and they are speaking French language. And remaining 1% of the people, they are speaking German language. Look here, 59% of the people, those who are lives in Flemish region, they are Dutch speakers. And the 40% of the people, they lives in a Wallonia region and they are speaking French language. And remaining 1% of the people, they are speaking German language. So, now let us discuss about the another one interesting thing, that is about the capital city of the Belgium, that is Brussels. The capital city of the Belgium is Brussels. The ethnic composition of the Brussels is too different. In Brussels, 80% of the people they are speaking French language. And remaining 20% of the people, they are speaking Dutch language. So 80% of the people, they are speaking French language and remaining 20% of the people, they are speaking Dutch language. So look here, the French speakers, those who are minority in the country, they are politically and economically so rich. The minority people, those who are speaking the French language, they are politically and economically, they are so rich. The Dutch speaking community is the majority one, even though they got benefit of economic development and education much later. So this led the conflicts and disputes and tension between the two communities, especially between the French and Dutch speakers, especially during 1950s and 1960s. The tension between in these two communities more acute in the capital city of Brussels, because this presented a special problem. Especially the Dutch speaking community people constituted a majority in the country but minority in the capital city. Dear students, even though in this situation the Belgian leaders, they had taken some steps to solve their ethnic problems by arranging the power sharing system in their government. Now, afterwards we are going to discuss about how they are solved their ethnic problems and the power sharing arrangement in Belgian government. Now, let us compare with the Sri Lanka. Now, we are going to discuss about the ethnic composition of Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka is an island nation. And it is also the small country, and the population of the Sri Lanka also, it is too less. It is about only 2 crore people. The major social groups of the Sri Lanka also like Belgium only. Here, there are two major language speakers, especially the Sinhala speakers and Tamil speakers. Let us discuss about the ethnic composition of Sri Lanka. In Sri Lanka, there are 74% of the people, they are speaking Sinhala language. And 18% of the people, they are speaking Tamil language. Those who are speaking 74% of the Sinhala language, they are all Buddhist. And the 18% of the Tamil language speakers are Hindus and Muslims. So, again, in this 18% of the Tamil speakers, among these Tamil speakers, again there are two subgroups. Tamil natives and they are also called as Sri Lankan Tamils. And the rest of the people are Indian Tamils. So, look here, dear students, among Tamil language speakers, there are two subgroups, Tamil natives, 13%, and also called Sri Lankan Tamils, and the remaining are Indian Tamils, whose forefathers are, during colonial period, they came from India and settled in Sri Lanka as a plantation workers, and they used to call as a Indian Tamils. Look at the textbook, page number 3. There you can observe the most of the Sri Lankan Tamils are concentrated in the north and east of the country. And most of the Sinhala speakers are Buddhist. And most of the Tamils are Hindus and Muslims. And 7% of the people, those who are speaking both the languages of Tamil and Sinhala, they are Christians. So, this is about the ethnic composition of Sri Lanka. 74% of the Sinhala speakers, they are almost all the Buddhist, and 18% of the Tamil speakers, they are Hindus and Muslims, and among Tamil speakers, again there are two subgroups, Tamil natives and also called as Sri Lankan Tamils and Indian Tamils, whose forefathers came as the plantation workers during the colonial period, and 7% of the Christians, they are speaking both Tamil and Sinhala languages. In this situation, you could imagine what will happen. In Belgium, the Dutch community could take advantage, and this would push the conflict among communities. And this could lead a very messy partition of the country also. In Sri Lanka, the Simhana community enjoyed and could impose its will on the entire country. Even there is a best example before us, that is about the partition of our country based on religious diversity. During 1947, India also partitioned based on religion. Now, let us discuss about majoritarianism in Sri Lanka. Majoritarianism in Sri Lanka. What is the meaning of majoritarianism? A belief that a majority community should be able to rule the country, in whichever way it wants by disregarding the wishes and needs of the minority communities. I hope you all of you understood the meaning of majoritarianism. Once again, I am going to repeat. Majoritarianism means it is a belief that the majority community should be able to rule the country in whichever way it wants by disregarding the wishes and needs of the minority communities. Sri Lanka emerged as an independent nation in 1948. And we already understood that in Sri Lanka, the Simhana speakers are majority communities. Here, the Simhana speakers, the leaders of the Simhana community, sought to secure the dominance over the government. And as a result, the democratically elected government adopted a series of majoritarian measures to establish Simhana supremacy in the country. To achieve their supremacy over government, the government of Sri Lanka passed an act in 1956. See, according to this 1956 act, it is recognized Simhana as an official language of the country. So, please look here. By passing an act in 1956, they have taken the different measures, especially the 1956 acts, so declared the Simhana as official language of the Sri Lanka. And the another one important, the government of Sri Lanka, by recognizing the Simhana as official language of the country, and it's completely disregarded the Tamil language and Tamil speech. And this is the first step. And the second thing, according to this act, so they are given a preferential provisions even in universities, colleges and government jobs and all, only for by recognizing Simhana speakers. And once again, they are disregarding the Tamil speakers. The second thing, that the government followed and given more preference for, and even the policies also like this, that favored Simhana applicants, especially for university positions and government jobs. So it is clear that they are going to give more opportunities for only the Simhana speakers and Buddhists. Once again, they are here also disregarded the Tamil speakers and the Tamil language. And also, a new constitution stipulated that state shall protect and foster the Buddhism. That means, so the Buddhism is considered as the religion, I mean the state religion. Actually, in a democratic countries, all religions are equal, but here, by protecting and fostering, so the Buddhism, it is considered as a state religion of the state, I mean Sri Lanka. So these are the three important steps taken by the Sri Lankan government to dominate over the minority communities, and even especially it is about so the rest of the communities, the Hindus, Muslims and Christians and Tamil speakers. So by passing an act, once again I am going to repeat this. So by passing the 1956 act, so they are taken these three major steps to establish their majority over the government. As a result of this situation, so the relationship between the both Simhala and Tamil speakers or the communities is strained over time. The Sri Lankan Tamils, they struggle for equal opportunities, equal political rights also, and even to consider or to recognize the Tamil language also as the official language of Sri Lanka. And even the Sri Lankan Tamils, they were fought for more autonomy and equal opportunity in securing education and even in job opportunities also. So by 1980s, several political organizations were formed, and even they are demanding for independent state also, which we called as a Tamil Eedam. The unsatisfied Tamil speakers and the rest of the communities, they were demanded for separate state, which is called as a Tamil Eedam. Eedam means state. I think all of you heard about one of the organization LTTE. That means Lanka Tamil Tiger Eedam. Then I would like to remember the situation of why the former Prime Minister of Sri Rajiv Gandhi killed by this LTTE. During this time, actually, our former Prime Minister Sri Rajiv Gandhi sent a force to maintain the peace in the Sri Lanka. Even many times they were requested also. And even during that time, the LTTE, it is considered or recognized as one of the separate private organization. Even it is under the what we call so the terror group. So when even though the Rajiv Gandhi sent a force to help to the Sri Lankan government, then the LTTE groups, they are taken revenge and they are killed Veerappan in Perambur, Madras. In Sri Lanka, the distrust between in these two major communities turned into widespread conflicts, and even it soon turned into a civil war. Civil war means it is a violent conflict between groups within a country. This is called as a civil war. And the result of this, the thousands of thousand people of the Sri Lankan, even the both the communities have been killed. And also many people lost their lives also. And many families were forced to leave the country as refugees also. And it is completely affected the economic condition and the political condition of the Sri Lanka. Dear students, this is the best example to understand. If suppose in any country, if the majority community or the majority social, religious or the linguistic groups, if they are going to dominate over the minority, then we can understand the result of that situation. It is completely affected on the economic condition of the country, the political system of the country, and even so, the most of the rest of the communities, I mean the minority communities, because of this majoritarianism, they are going to be suffered a lot, and this is not a good sign of the democratic system. So that's what, dear students, it is a very essential to share the power among all the groups, whether they are speaking different languages, whether they are speaking the different language or any religious or social groups, or maybe they may belong to any category. So that's what it is very essential to arrange the power sharing system, especially in a democratic countries. In this situation, the small country of the Europe, the Belgium, it has become the model for other democratic countries because of its power sharing system. Now, in the next class, we are going to discuss about the elements of or the power sharing arrangements of the Belgium country. Thank you. Have a nice day.